Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining one more time for the Grand Piano Series lecture pre-concert talk. And today we're excited to feature Magdalena Bachevska, who is going to prepare us for the upcoming concert of Barry Douglas on March 14 at 7:30 p.m. in Bonita Springs at St. Leo Auditorium. If you don't have your tickets yet, join us for this Irish legendary, incredible pianist. And we can't wait to hear what this program is going to be about. So Magdalena, thank you for leading us into this wonderful musical journey.
Thank you so much, Milan. And thank you all of you for coming to join us this morning again. You are in for quite a treat with the recital of Barry Douglas, who is the gold medalist of the Tchaikovsky competition. And Tchaikovsky, he will play during this recital. Among other, there will be also music of Schubert and Prokofiev. But what they all have in common is that they are so-called character pieces, or piano miniatures or character pieces. All it really means that it is a short instrumental piece of music that sort of stands on its own, that is given a evocative, extra musical title. And piano miniatures would usually be, you know, these kind of freestanding vignettes, and they stayed on the short side as opposed to other genres that really kind of exploded during the 19th century, such as symphony, opera, and symphonic poem. These character pieces must have really been a very useful vehicle of expression for composers, because they sort of carried through to the 20th and the 21st century. And in fact, character pieces are still being written as we speak. Sometimes character pieces were grouped into larger cycles, and you will hear that today when we speak of the seasons or of the Schubert and impromptu. But they do stand very well on their own, and they often make for wonderful selections for encores. Let's start with the music of Tchaikovsky in order of Barry Douglas's recital. In this case, we're dealing with pieces with descriptive titles, and these titles are actually just the names of the months. So Tchaikovsky was commissioned to write 12 pieces, one for each month of the year. And it was in 1875. And the person who commissioned was the editor of the St. Petersburg music magazine, a Nouvelle Liste, by the name of Nikolai Bernard. And when you talk about a wonderful sales and marketing move, this was something that Bernard requested of Tchaikovsky for the 1876 editions of the magazine, so that one piece would be released every month and would encourage the sales of the magazine. Tchaikovsky was sort of in between very big important projects. His first piano concerto, which really put him on the international stage, it was premiered by Hans von Bülow. He was also in the midst of writing Swan Lake. So this project was not necessarily the biggest one that he has had. It was a commission. It helped him pay the bills. But the music, nevertheless, is delightful. What's interesting about Tchaikovsky himself is that he was actually groomed to become a civil servant. And as a young man, for a while, he even worked for the Department of Justice. But his love of music made him abandon that career. And as soon as he found out that there was a newly established St. Petersburg Conservatory, he ran over and got his degree in music there. What's also interesting, that at the same time, there existed a group of composers who favored toward a much more national style of writing music. They were collectively referred to as the Five or the Mighty Bunch. And some of the names that may ring a bell is Milli Balakirev. He was the leader of the group. Cesar Cui, Modest Mussorgsky, Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov, and Alexander Borodin. And so they all favored, they were actually not trained formally in composition, but they wrote music that had this very national character. Tchaikovsky was much more interested in an existence beyond that national scene. He wanted to write music that goes beyond national borders. Here is the a few selections, because Barry Douglas will only play four of the selections. And these are a perfect example of short character pieces for solo piano. I suppose the only requirement for character pieces is that they don't have words attached to them. However, here we actually have short snippets of poems that go with each miniature. So I'm going to share with you a few, because we don't have time to talk about everything and there's so much wonderful music to discuss. Let me play for you February, which comes with a short poem, "At the lively Mardi Gras, soon a large feast will overflow." And each of the months has also a subtitle. The February subtitle, as you can probably guess from the poem, is Carnival. And I'm going to share my screen and we're going to hear Olga Sheps playing a snippet of Carnival. Okay, please give me a thumbs up if the sound is okay. I'm going to make full screen. And then we come back to the A section, to the main material that we heard at the beginning. So as you can hear, there's a lot of merrymaking. There seems to be a lot of commotion. You can feel almost a crowd of people celebrating in this music. The seasons were often orchestrated, and actually the piece exists in many different orchestrations, and I want to share with you a snippet of one of them, and here is again Carnival. Going to stop here because we want to focus on piano music for this recital. And here is a short fragment by the queen of the piano, Marta Argerich, playing the autumn song, and which is October. And that's what you're also going to hear Barry Douglas play. The short poem that goes with it is by Tolstoy. It reads, "Autumn, our poor garden is all falling down. The yellowed leaves are flying in the wind." So let's try, as we are listening, let's try to compare how this merrymaking of the carnival differs from the expression of leaves falling down and the fall in full swing. I'm going to stop right here at the cadence. As you have already noticed, the tempo is much slower. The accompaniment slows down from this dance-like February carnival. And the melody is much more wistful, one could say, much more kind of singing, cantabile melody. And if you may have caught, there is just a tiny tinge of chromaticism, meaning the rather tight, you know, essentially one key right next to another, so that these are the smallest intervals in Western music. When you play all the keys of the piano as closely as possible without skipping any, that is chromaticism. And that what that usually symbolizes is some sort of a sadness or grief. And here, Tchaikovsky is very skillfully inserting this in the October autumn song. One of my favorites, perhaps, and maybe one of the best known months here is December, which is subtitled Christmas. And the poem reads, "Once upon a Christmas night, the girls were telling fortunes, taking their slippers off their feet and throwing them out of the gate." And let's listen to Vladimir Ashkenazy playing this very famous, what is essentially a waltz. So you're going to hear a dance. Let's listen. Stop right here. So you can almost feel this twirling, this round movement of the waltz. And of course, the audience didn't even have to be told at the time that it was a waltz, because the dance was really all the rage. It had made its way to all the ballrooms of Europe, and everybody wanted to dance waltz. It was one of those very intimate dances where dancers could dance even cheek to cheek. So the kind of the closeness, the intimacy of the dance was definitely emphasized. And Tchaikovsky certainly knew how to write his dances. Just for comparison, I want to share with you the dance of the Waltz of the Flowers from the Nutcracker Ballet. This is written a little bit later, but the waltz seems to really have an important place in Tchaikovsky's output. So let's just delight our senses here for a moment with this George Balanchine choreography of the Waltz of the Flowers. Thank you. it's so sad to have to stop, but we're going to keep focused on piano music. And I do promise that I will send the links to Milana as always so that she can share them with you all. So the Nutcracker is from 1892. And one more waltz that I want to share with you, because what's important to remember is that while some waltzes were actually written to accompany dance, the character pieces that are dances, so a waltz in this case, were, so to say, stylized, meaning that they actually were not written for the presence of the dancers. Here is one more waltz by Tchaikovsky from his 1878 opera Eugene Onegin. Again, it's so painful to have to stop, but now you have a better idea of how the waltz works, and you're going to see Barry Douglas, you know, invariably with that umpapa accompaniment in the left hand. What's delightful about December of Tchaikovsky is that it has this sort of rhythmic ambiguity, that it works both in two and in three, in duple and triple meters. So when you are listening to it, maybe one more time before the concert, it would be lovely to just sort of try to count both to three and to two and appreciate that wonderful tension. We move now to the music of Franz Schubert, an Austrian composer born right outside of Vienna, who became famous in his very, very short life of 31 years. He became famous for his symphonies, piano sonatas, and I'm sure you have already heard some during the Great Grand Piano Series concerts, as well as his 600 art songs. So Schubert seems to have had this wonderful affinity and amazing talent for setting text to music. And again, we are here to focus on solo music, but it's really important to understand a fuller picture of a composer by getting to know some of his other music. So I want to propose that we listen for a moment to one of the most famous art songs by Franz Schubert, and that is the Erl König, or the Erl King, set to the words of Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. This is just to show you how with the contrasting worlds that Schubert built through music, with just painting the text. So you're just going to hear a short snippet where you have four characters: narrator, the father, the son, and the Erl König, or the Elf King, who is luring the feverish child to come with him, while the father insists on this being some sort of a natural phenomenon that can be empirically and reasonably explained. This is a recording with Jesse Norman. Now you're about to hear the father asking the boy, "What is wrong? Why is your face so pale?" And the son responds, Don't you see, Daddy? There is this elf king chasing us.
Mein Sohn, was birgst du so pack mit deinem Gesicht? Siehst Vater du den Erlken nicht? Den Erlken mit Kron und Schweif? Mein Sohn, es ist ein Nebelstreif.
Father says, my son, this is just the mist. Don't worry about it. I can explain it. And now just a few more seconds where the Erlkönig is luring the young boy, saying, come with me. There are wonderful things awaiting. Just listen to how Schubert is setting this really rather creepy text to music.
Es geht, komm, geh mit mir, gar schöne Spiele spiel ich mit dir. Manch bunte Blumen sät an dem Strand, meine Mutter hat manch Güten gefand.
I will stop right here. So this is the world that Schubert shares with us through his art song, through his lieder. And as I mentioned, there are over 600 of them. Now, his piano music is adorned with rather simple titles, not terribly descriptive. So while Schumann may be writing a piece called A Child Falling Asleep, and Liszt may be writing these epic pieces called the Dante Sonata or Mephisto Waltz, again alluding to the poetry of Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, Schubert writes a piece, a cycle of pieces, in fact, under the title of Impromptu. So improvised. They are not improvised because they're written down for us pianists to enjoy many years later. However, they really seem to allude to the practice of great fashion for improvisation in the 19th century. As we know, musicians would get together and have the so-called playoffs by the end of which there was a winner each evening. So the best improvisation was rewarded by the audience. And so here, Schubert is really musing in a way. And I'd like to lead you through one of the impromptus, which is actually this one here in the B flat major. This is opus 142. It was published posthumously. And it is a cycle of variations. So as you see here, it's this thema, so a theme, and the sort of the reworking of this melody throughout the impromptu. It's a rather large piece. So I will show you snippet by snippet how that kind of form works. So let's take a good listen to this theme here played by Christian Zimmermann so that we can enjoy how it is reworked. I will play only this much. And so what you're hearing is a very romantic kind of texture with a beautiful singing melody, which appears in octaves in a moment. And it has this very serene character. However, we must be always careful because in the music of Schubert, the smile tends to always come through the tears. So the emotion is never just simple. It's never just one thing. thing. The left-hand accompaniment is also rather simple. It almost brings to mind the classical style. We must remember that Schubert was born in 1797, so still in 18th century. And when he was making his first steps as a composer, Salieri was still alive. And Salieri, as you might remember from the movie Amadeus, was Mozart's frenemy or the nemesis. And he was the one who had all the good jobs at the royal, at the imperial court. And it was Salieri who noticed the talent of young Schubert and decided to teach him. So Schubert is certainly still coming out of the classical tradition, but already introducing the complexity of emotion, romantic emotion, in his piece. Okay, we're going to now, I hope that you took a good listen to that melody, because we're moving now to variation 1, 2035. So instead of da di da 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 di do da da, we have now this multitude of notes, but yet the main structure remains. The harmonies are the same, and so is the character. The left hand, and I should probably play it one more time so you get a better listen. The left hand already introduces what we call syncopations, and that always means tension. So As I said before, while the melody may seem all peppy and serene, there is this undercurrent of tension. Let's just take one more listen. Right here. Okay, at 22 minutes, we move to the next variation. Let's see what it brings. And I'm only playing just a fragment of the theme just for the sake of time. So we seem to be departing farther and farther away from the actual main melody. That's why it's so important to really internalize it at the very beginning. And I believe that Barry Douglas will play it twice as Schubert would have intended. So each half of the melody, as you can see here, even that this is the musical notation that signifies a repeat. So it is for that reason that Schubert wants to have this music presented twice. Okay, at 23:31, we move to the next variation 3. So here you notice right away something changes. We are in a much more somber mood, and that is the change of mode from major, a rather happy sounding mode, into minor. And we have these kind of intense triplets in the left hand, sort of driving the piece forward. So we're a long way away from da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, as you can hear. So it seems that we're sort of entering further and further into the forest. 25:31, we hear a total change. Thank you. seems that the theme has completely dissolved, that we may have even left or sort of cut ourselves off from that initial melody. But upon closer listening, you actually will notice that it is the left hand playing the resemblance of the melody. We have completely modulated. We're in a key of G flat major, and this variation really seems to sort of go off to a different world. Speaking of G flat major, I'm just thinking about the G flat major impromptu, which is in the other opus, is in opus 90, that was published during Schubert's time. And as you see here, there are these six flats and the key signature. These would have been very difficult to read for amateur pianists. And we know that, you know, since the middle class was blossoming at the time, there were many people who wished to study music. And so these six flats here would have made the music rather difficult to learn. We know that, of course, Schubert and other composers very much relied on publishing music as their source of income, among others. And so this impromptu ended up being published first in simple G major without all the worries for the black keys and all the flats. Key signature. So the focus was on accessibility of this material, because I want to lead you to the next variation at 2735. So you hear this delightful rippling of the notes that sound like just a pearl necklace. Each sound, each pitch really is this perfect little pearl. So the emphasis is, of course, on the evenness, but also the beauty of sound. As always, you have these syncopated left-hand accompaniment that in this case plays with us a little bit. Is it a little flirtatious? Are we done with all the tension in the piece for now? Well, let's see. The coda, meaning the tail of the piece, is coming up right here. And finally, after, you know, this significant amount of time, you're going to hear the melody the way you heard it at the beginning. So you finally have the melody restated here at the end. So it only makes you realize what a long way you have come, what a journey it has been. Now, very quickly, because I do want to get to Prokofiev with plenty of time, just a fragment of the first impromptu in Opus 90, so published, as I mentioned, during Schubert's life. I really like what Mitsuko Uchida, a pianist who actually just performed at Carnegie Hall 2 days ago, says about Schubert, and she plays Schubert so well. She said, you know, he takes you to these places that he creates in music are really out of this world, and he takes you there. So I really like to think of that. In this first impromptu, you're going to hear a loud octave, which is rather long, and it makes you wonder where this piece might be going next. It's especially exciting for first-time listeners.
Thank you.
It is incredibly long. It is almost uncomfortable, but it allows you to really travel with the sound wave and start breathing in that mood of the piece. And now you're going to hear this march-like melody, which is so bare. It's only played by one hand. And for somebody like Schubert, who of course was a master of the texture and writing, you know, melodies, he decides to just write one single tune without accompaniment. What you just heard was the answer of the for the antecedent of the melody, and the answer is already in a chordal texture, and but it's very austere. It doesn't seem to bring us much relief, right, from that very single note, you know, really signifying solitude and maybe abandonment and loneliness. That answer with the chorus doesn't really give us much relief. So now, last but not least, I am very pleased to go to the music of Prokofiev, a very exciting piece that, of course, has so many connotations, so many layers. The suite from Romeo and Juliet, as we know, the masterpiece, early masterpiece by William Shakespeare. Prokofiev was also, just like Tchaikovsky, trained at the St. Petersburg Conservatory, and he was first known as a composer, pianist, but he really wasn't so crazy about touring later on. He did not like making his living as a pianist. It was tiring, and he much preferred to compose. After the 1917 revolution, with the permission of the authorities, Prokofiev left Russia and moved to the United States first, then lived in Paris as well as Germany. And he was touring as a pianist, excuse me, and a conductor. He was very famous for his ballets. It was, but you know, in the West during the Great Depression, it became increasingly difficult to put on these great productions and to get new work. So in 1936, Prokofiev and his family decide to return and live in Russia. And so from now on, he's the Soviet composer. His relationship to the authorities could be a subject of a whole different talk. But among his early successes back in Soviet Russia is Romeo and Juliet, a ballet. So what Prokofiev does a few years after the publishing of the ballet is take some of the sort of greatest hits and create a piano suite of character pieces. Again, they can stand very well on their own as these vignettes. Some of them may be played as encores, but the piece is often performed in its entirety as a suite, and that's how you're going to hear it in Barry Douglas's concert. The piece is also performed as a suite for orchestra, meaning that the musicians, orchestra musicians, would simply stay on stage and the dancers would be absent. So I have a couple of different versions to share with you. Let's start here with the simply orchestral version, because what I want you to appreciate is the colors, the instrumentation, the rich sound effects that Prokofiev is here thinking about. And what you'll be hearing is the fragment of this feud of the two families, the Capulets and the Montagues. Let's listen. Thank you. here. We just stopped in the perfect moment. We have these blasting tubas, trombones, we have snare drums, and we have an army of strings involved in playing this rather tense melody featuring these dotted rhythms, yum, pa-pam, pa-pam, right? Now I want to share with you the core of this as a ballet, which was the initial concept. And this is the choreography of Rudolf Nureyev. In the ballet, it's called The Dance of the Knights. It's the same music. So you hear this pride of the two families and it's kind of the unwillingness of to give in. And we finally get here to the piano version here interpreted by Evgeny Kisin. So as you listen, keep in mind that this piece was first written for an orchestra. So a pianist who wishes to successfully perform this piece must have all these orchestral colors in mind when playing. So right here, for example, you could hear how Prokofiev is setting these snare drums for the piano, these very crunchy, quick chords. Since we don't have terribly a lot of time, I'm going to skip the purely orchestral version here of Young Juliet. It is the most delightful description of a 13-year-old girl who's the daughter of the Capulet family, and of course she's the protagonist here in the tragedy as well as in the ballet. Just listen to how Prokofiev imagines Juliet with these quick notes, very, very light, and so it's her giddiness, it's her youth and her excitement that we are hearing. At the same time, Prokofiev is really playing here with tonality, so the harmonies continue to surprise our ears. So yes, the entire movement actually starts with just a simple C major scale, and you're going to hear it here on the piano. I will stop right here because I want to show you the amazing contrast that Prokofiev builds here from Young Juliet to Friar Lawrence, who is the one to advise the young couple, and he secretly marries them, really in good intentions to end the feuds between the two families. Ultimately, his advice is really the beginning of the end. But let's listen to his wisdom and modesty here that Prokofiev portrays through the music. I will stop here. So as you hear, the music is so full of color and so full of contrast between the young Juliet, running around with the keyboard, literally here, and the father, Friar Lawrence, with his chorale-like sort of religious tone. One more contrast comes from Mercutio, who is Romeo's friend, as you know, and he is very temperamental. And this is a short fragment here of the choreography. And listen to how the music describes Mercutio's boisterous temperament. Just a few seconds of that so that you can now hear it in the piano version played by Ivo Pogorelić. So here, Prokofiev is really a great storyteller. We see allegro giocoso, so jokingly, brusco, brusque, con brio, with life, with spirit. We also see plenty of accents in somewhat unexpected places as well. So we have the umpapa figures, but they're accented in these rather unexpected places. And that very much describes this temperament and the personality of Mercutio, who can be a little unpredictable and maybe not always super appropriate. Before we run out of time, I want to show you this just heartbreakingly beautiful moment from the balcony scene before the parting of Romeo and Juliet. Let's listen first the piano version, and then I will show you the choreography. There is this wonderful way in which Prokofiev is reaching. This is a difficult interval to perform, you know, for a singer, for a violinist. On the piano, of course, it's much, much easier. But the idea is for the pianist, and I'm sure you'll hear it in a masterful interpretation of Barry Douglas, this lovely yearning that is enclosed in this melody here. And just for dessert, I will play a few seconds of the choreography by Kenneth MacMillan. It's the famous Pas de Deux, and you will hear that same yearning melody over here as well. I will stop right here again with a promise of sending you all the links afterwards. So as you have noticed, there is literally an entire universe of sound, of content, of storytelling when a pianist sits down to the piano to play a character piece, right? We are imagining fairy tales, myths. We are imagining the great love stories. We're imagining dancers. So Maybe you'll get lucky enough to have a word with Barry Douglas after the performance, to speak with him and ask what goes through his head when he performs this music. But as you see, there's just this wealth of references and extra musical connotations when the character pieces are performed. So with that, I'm going to thank you for listening. And if there are any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you, Magdalena. And yes, if anybody has any questions, you're welcome to ask them right now. This was fascinating. Thank you. I can't wait for the concert, honestly speaking. It's just going to be a fantastic program, gorgeous music, and it's going to be a treat to see and hear Barry Douglas live in our community. You know, he was supposed to come a few times in the past years to the Philharmonic Orchestra and our series, and things got canceled. So I'm very excited to have him finally on our series. So,
and you have this most delicious piano for him to play on. So this really will be a treat for him as well, I believe.
So I'm excited. Does anybody have any questions?
I don't really have a question, but I wanted to say thank you. I've always loved Schubert, and I never really knew why. I mean, now that you've explained it, I probably need therapy, but, you know, it was really good.
I think we all do, yes. But let Schubert be the therapy for all of us. Well, thank you, Dean, for your comments. It's really lovely.
Anybody else? Do you have any comments? Well, if nobody has any comments, I look forward to seeing you all at our concert on Tuesday. And for those who don't have their tickets yet, I highly encourage you to get the tickets for our Tuesday concert on March 14 at 7:30 p.m. at St. Leo. And as always, kids and students can get free tickets. So if anybody knows any families who would like to bring their children to the concerts, we are thrilled to have them join us. So I thank you, Magdalena, for a fantastic lecture. And until next time.
Wonderful. Thank you all so much. Enjoy the rest of the weekend.
Thank you, Magdalena.
Bye, guys. Bye.